All right, good afternoon, everyone. It looks like we're settled on this snowy Friday afternoon. Welcome to the Jack Joseph and Morton Mandel School of Applied Social Sciences. This is the fourth in our Centennial Research and Training Colloquia series. It's the first for this semester. I'm Elizabeth Tracy. I'm professor and I'm associate dean for research and training at the school. This colloquia series is sponsored by the Office of Research Administration and the doctoral program. And I think most of you saw the list of colloquia for the year, so we welcome you to come back as the year progresses. A few logistics, restrooms are down the hall to your right. The CEU certificates and the sign up for PD hours is at the registration table where you came in. And I have some well-deserved thank yous to Ina Brand and Carm Gambatese, who were at the registration desk, and Tracy Braden, who helps with many aspects of this program. We'll have a question and answer time, and for that we'll be using this mic that Lee Taylor will bring the mic to you. That's Lee down here. So, this is so that we can all hear the question, and also for our many remote viewers. I think we had 23 people, in addition to the people who are here in this room, who signed up to view this remotely. So we want to include them. And you can email questions during the answer question time to mandelschool@case.edu if you're watching remotely. Otherwise, if you're speaking a question, we ask you to wait until Lee runs over to you with the mic. Right? I've stopped doing this role. Our centennial theme this year is featuring our own, and so we are focusing this year on the cutting edge research that's done at the Mandel School. And today's topic, use of community data by nonprofits, is presented by Dr. Robert Fisher. You know him as a faculty member of the school, as co-director of the Center for Poverty and Community Development, and also as the faculty director of the Master of Nonprofit Organization, the MNO degree. How many MNO students do we have here today? You want to raise your hands? Oh, you made a very good decision to come today, I would say. So with that, there will be at 2 p.m., there'll be time for you to talk informally with Rob about this topic, and that'll be here in this building in room 114. So whatever candy is left over, you can take over there and talk for a little bit. So now, please join me in welcoming Dr. Fisher.
Thank you. Well, good afternoon. It's great to see you all here today. The snow kicks up behind you. It's quite a sight for me to look at. We're here talking about a topic that's very near and dear to my heart. And in the last 2 weeks, I thought about retitling this Use of Alternative Facts by Nonprofit Organizations. So now we have lots of new options for data that we could draw on in our work. So my agenda today is to talk about a lot about the challenges that we face in making effective use of community data by nonprofits, but also to talk about some work we've been doing nationally looking at efforts to increase the amount of data that's available to communities and the nonprofits that serve there. And I will also talk a little bit about our own opportunities here in the Cleveland region. So I want to talk a bit about community data. You like that? I don't have any answers. I'm a nonprofit. If you put in Google nonprofit and data, surprisingly a lot of cartoons pop up. So that might tell us something about expectations. And then also going into talking about both the importance of the use of these data, but also efforts to support it, which is a major theme. And then particularly looking at the experiences of some communities that have made a concerted effort to do this kind of work. And as we go, I know you've been scolded about questioning, so please, you know, make a note. If I say anything that seems it needs a question later, please make a note, and there'll be plenty of time for those at the end. So first, I want to make the pitch around why data are important to community organizations, and particularly nonprofits. And as somebody who spends a lot of time evaluating, I know that's probably a go-to feeling for most of us. We think, well, we need outcome data, and we need to prove effectiveness, and we need to be accountable. But I want to start with the idea that those same data can be influential in lots of types of decision making that our leadership and even at the supervisory and direct practice level are faced with making. And the first one is around simply demonstrating need and understanding need. I think we're pretty good at demonstrating need. We know the right statistics to pull. We can get the data. In many cases, nonprofit partners that I work with, they have a standard need statement that they attach to every proposal because the need is so compelling. It's the understanding of the need, what drives it, what has brought it to the fore, and by continuation from that thought, the idea of why what we're planning to do, why this leverage point makes sense given how the need plays out. So I really want to make that pitch. So that's one big bucket of data use. Another is that informing our work in practice. So in the implementation of programs, the direct service and on the ground work, that it's informing both the planning of that process and how we articulate what the program is about. And here I use program to be inclusive of all things from workshops to initiatives to media campaigns, anything that nonprofit partners might be engaged in that have an objective around individual or community level change. And then the last bucket is that idea that we do want to assess community change, looking at trends over time. So many of the data that become available to us tell us what's going on in our neighborhood or our city, and we can look at that time trend. And we confront that in two ways. One is it continues to speak to need, but sometimes, depending on what we're doing, it also tells us about how well we're doing. If we have ambitious goals around changing some indicator in a neighborhood or at the city level, then we're trying to see differences in time about moving those metrics. So these are all categories where we hope to use data to better inform decision making. And I reframe this in these three categories. I'm not going to go through all the elements, but basically it's that idea that nonprofits are expected to monitor mission, that they are in touch with the communities they serve, that they need data to make the right decisions about what to do practice-wise, and that they need to communicate about themselves, both perhaps as an outcome, promoting awareness of topics, but also, you know, I put the last thing here, solicit resources. You know, in reality, I think for many of our partners, that's number one. It's we want to use data because we can be more effective in garnering support from funders. And this is one of those places, you know, I teach in the classroom and students say, well, that's not the way it works, Dr. Fisher, in my job, in my agency. And I have to say, well, we're not training you for the current environment. We're training you for when you're leading these organizations and how you can get data, make data a bigger player in decision making. So I want to attach this to this discussion of data, because it seems rather amorphous, to the notion that nonprofits writ large are really, part of their mission is about community building. And that missions, nonprofit missions, however they are articulated, in whatever depth, connect to community members, residents, target populations, communities of people, however aggregated. And that the nonprofit mission demands that we be in touch with data. And in the old days, we would just say, be in touch with our constituents, be in touch with our clientele. But now we have so many opportunities, in addition to that direct contact, to have data at different levels. So, you know, nonprofit boards are charged with administering and monitoring the mission of their organization. And part of that story now is around effective use of data. And certainly many of our nonprofits, as part of their mission, are not just being responsive to community, but are building community directly through action, through resident associations, through investing in neighborhood work and neighborhood leadership. So there's a category of nonprofits that that certainly own this as a priority, but I think all nonprofits have to see this as part of their agenda of change. So I do want to put a lot of this responsibility at the foot of the nonprofit board, because from the nonprofit board to the executive director down to the staff, this is how use of data happens. It's very hard as an individual in an organization to promote the use of data if you're somewhere lower in the org chart. So it has to be something that top management has seen as a priority. And it's all about that translation of vision into action. So in the last 15 years, roughly, we've seen this growth in technology and underlying data that's changed the landscape for us in the nonprofit sector. We still have the ability to get data on our communities from the ones we've used for many years. Anecdote is number one. The compelling story is still a form of data that is important, and I would never advise any nonprofit partner to just move to metrics, because metrics alone don't communicate the depth and the meaning of the circumstances. The analogy I always use is when presidents give their State of the Union address, they talk about their policy proposals. Of course, I don't know what President Trump will do, but they talk about their proposal and then they point to someone who's seated in the box, who exemplifies the importance of what's just been talked about. And you can see people light up when they see the armed services member or the mother of the fallen son or whatever the case is. So that anecdote personalizes the data, and that's very important. So the second part of this is around GIS and what that has brought to us in the sector, both the challenges and the opportunities. But it's the idea that now we can do better in understanding geospatially both need and deployment of services. So if you think of the landscape of our community and imagine a map that shows you social indicator data is thematic in the background, and then dot points showing service providers of different types. This is the movement that I'll be talking about is really trying to do, bringing together both need and assets together in the same space so that nonprofits can better deploy their particular efforts. And I want to come back to this piece about accountability, because we have gone through in the last 30 years a radical shift in expectations of the sector, going from a reputational accountability of the past. Our longest serving nonprofits have, for many years, that was all you needed to know, was who the organization was. And over time, we have shifted in the sector from focusing on organizations to focusing on programs. So the unit of importance in many ways becomes the program, and that opens the door, that levels the playing field for smaller organizations new to the scene to compete against long-standing nonprofits. And so shifting from things like the quality of the staff and the inputs that we use as markers of importance to focusing on what we get through the program. What is the yield? What is the return on investment, social or otherwise? So this has changed how our nonprofit partners think about themselves and how they are forced to communicate about their work. And it amps up, in many ways, the need for data to support this kind of dialogue. Now this, oh, I got one more here. As I was thinking about it and the accountability structures, I think all of us, if we've served in a nonprofit, served on a board, volunteered, we know that there's an accountability within the sector and within individual organizations. But if you think about the plethora of accountability that nonprofits are expected to respond to, both upstream from the organization to many of our financial partners, but also to perhaps our national associations, lateral accountability within the organization, and inclusive of our organizational partners that we collaborate with, and then accountability to clients, beneficiaries, and the broader community. I think it would be challenging to find other entities that have as many streams of accountability expectations for them and are so under-resourced to respond to them. So that's a key point. This may be a case where I got a little aggressive with how deeply I wanted to go on this particular topic. But let me just say one thing, because I always get the question, well, how do we get here? What led to this? Why is it like this? And the one thing we know is that our funders have changed the nonprofit world. The expectations from the government sector and from within the nonprofit sector have greatly increased demand for the use of data through various means. In the bottom right here, direct donors have also, through increased transparency and the internet, our consumers have increased their demands for us to use data better. And then to explain why the business sector has such an influence, no, it's not that they might be a contributor through philanthropic work, they might be a partner in some of the work, but the avenue for that influence is really through boards and volunteers from the business sector, bringing their language and their interests to the nonprofit partner. So boards relish having business sector partners on them. Not all nonprofits, when I have business people on them, and they come in and they talk about lean management and continuous quality improvement and all these things. And that changes how the nonprofit, changes the language and culture within the nonprofit over time. So here's all the influences. And that brings us to this moment. We've got all these data demands. And what's the key phrase that we hear at this moment in JAWS? We're gonna need a bigger boat. He's just seen the shark, he's seen the size of it, backs up and says, we're gonna need a bigger boat. And for data use, we're gonna need a bigger boat. We need more guns, horses, whatever it takes. We need more capacity to respond to all these demands. And the fact is, we don't have a bigger boat. We're gonna have to figure out how to do this with what we've got. So I don't want to set this up as, well, if we just had the data as the nonprofit, we'd use it. Because that's not the case. From national survey data of nonprofits, what we've seen is that most are collecting data, but they're not making very good use of it already. So in this national sample of several hundred nonprofits, 6% of respondents felt that their organization was effectively making use of the data that they already had. So that's a troubling finding. And if you look at the bottom here, these are across different domains. Human services beats the others in terms of, this is decision-making processes are generally informed by data. So we should ask ourselves, you know, when the majority of decisions aren't informed by data, what are they informed by? Alternative sources of information. Now, I do not want to discount professional training and the role of direct practice learning and the expertise that our boards and our senior staff have, because that's crucial. But the argument is that every decision will incrementally be better if data are present. And I've been at a lot of decisions where the data are present and they don't make a difference. They are dispatched. I would rather have that happen than to not have the data there at all. Because the data about what the need looks like and what's an effective route to go programmatically, If someone objects to those data and has an alternative perspective, it should be a dialogue. It shouldn't be because we just don't know. So I'm leaving lots of gaps here for I want to get more data involved, but I know that the decisions are imperfect. They are human processes that will, I hope over time, make better use of these data that could be influential. And as a data guy, I have to admit a lot of the data are not good. They're not helpful. They're not on point. They're not current. There's so many problems with potential data that could be brought into the discussion that we have to expect sometimes it's better to set the data aside. So this last point about internal capacity is a major thing. If we have the data, why aren't we using it? Categories that would be no surprise to us. Lack of time to make use of the data, lack of experience in using it, lack of data tools. So here, analytic tools, ways of maintaining. If we do everything in Excel, how far can we get? And we can actually get pretty far as an organization with Excel, but you have to have somebody that is good at that. And so this puts, again, some of the burden within the organization. It's not just that data are hard to get, it's there has to be a process that supports its use within a nonprofit. All right, so I wanted to give a definition about what I mean by community data. And I thought about these three categories, those that the nonprofit serves, those in the areas the nonprofit serves, and then those in the broader community. So for me, this is all about people. But certainly some of the metrics we might think of are calculated on other bases, like property-related vacancies, abandoned homes, those sorts of things. But in general, these three categories, as we go to hunt for data that's relevant, on the right-hand side, the kinds of sources for those that we now serve, that's who we know the most about. Right? We have our own records. We have our own programmatic. We have requests for service. We have enrollment data. We have participation data and the like. So those are generally a good starting place for us. Those are data about the community, the people that choose to engage with us. We could also choose to collect direct data through various methods like survey, interview, focus group, where we do this, and many nonprofits will do this as part of a strategic planning effort, which is very good, but it's usually done in a tight time window. It's not a repeated process. It's done every 3 years or 5 years, and I think that brings into question whether that's enough continuity in connection with what's going on in the community to be as useful as it might. And then I tucked in integrated data here, which is increasingly becoming an option for nonprofit partners. The integrated data is where we have data sharing across organizations, where we link together records, and so two nonprofits and maybe a government, they've linked together their records. They know who each of them serves and who is served by multiple partners. And this helps us understand not only our clients, but how they are served by our sister organizations. Rebecca Dorman, who's the head of the county's Invest in Children program, always talks about how every organization talks about our clients. They're ours, as if they're not touched by numerous other community partners. And in a service-rich environment like we have in Cleveland, it would be foolish to not acknowledge the extent to which our families are in contact with multiple service providers at the same time and how that is felt by clients and families trying to be engaged. We wonder about why engagement is low. If 12 organizations are trying to engage you, then you're going to have to make choices about what's doable. So if we go up one level now to the neighborhood level, now we can draw on a couple of new sources. The census through the American Community Survey would be one. Public entities that operate in a specific area will often report data down to the neighborhood level. Our peer organizations, if we're not sharing data and integrating data with peers, maybe our peer organizations who serve the same neighborhoods are reporting counts of different types of clients with different characteristics. And then we can get lucky and have access to studies single studies or multiple longitudinal studies that have been conducted by external researchers to look at the same neighborhoods. And then blowing out one further level to the fuller community in here, I think about city and county, we have all those same sources in the above, and then sometimes we also have what we might consider polling data, which would be representative samples of individuals where we may not have a sufficient count in our neighborhood to estimate what's true in St. Clair Superior, but what we from a sample of 1,200 in Cleveland, we can estimate what's true in Cleveland. So that's another source that becomes available. So these different strata of community data should all be on our mind. And you know, I would recommend, as a nonprofit decision maker, to keep a data inventory of, here's the things we have in-house, here's the things on our wish list of data. Just knowing whether data exists and who has it is the first step, because the negotiation process can often take multiple years to get access to data, unfortunately. But if you don't even know relevant data exists, you don't know to ask the questions. All right, so I'm coming forward now to this, I want to introduce this work that we've done nationally, this increase in technology, the ability to store massive amounts of data, the big data movement, if you use that term. We think more about it as the integrated data movement, where the focus is on good, not on selling you something. And particularly for the nonprofit sector, the marrying of data from the census to data on nonprofit services filed through the Internal Revenue Service through the Form 990, which have become available and in electronic form, and also United Way's 211 service, which is individual level requests for service. And to varying degrees, those data have also become available. So we have this huge uptick in data availability. We've got better technology to process those data and manage it. So the opportunities are big. And over this span of over a couple of decades, what we've seen is communities have responded to the kinds of needs that we just talked about. They've said, we need to invest in making data more available in our community. So we have a bunch of initiatives. How many of us in the room know NeoCanDo or the former CanDo? Come on, people. I hope we'll come back to it in a minute. But you know, Cleveland has been on the map since over that entire period as one of the first to invest in this kind of work. So we have regional data depositories that have social indicator data. That's how I would describe NeoCanDo, making it available, web-based. Originally, NeoCanDo was a dial-up modem operation. Now it's, you know, fully accessible. And in more recent iterations, adding functionality that allows people to map and visualize data is the latest advances. And the goal is always extending beyond understanding community need to also understanding assets that are available. So I'm going to call to your attention these five initiatives that have played out over since 1995. The National Neighborhood Indicators Partnership is of which NeoCanDo and Claudia Colton are founding members of that partnership, has roughly 36, 38 cities around the country that are like us. They are social indicator warehouses that make data available to their communities. So those have been around a long time. This was not a as far as movements go, it was very grassroots. So every one of these looks different. The data that they have in them is all very different. Their geographies are different. And that means if you're here in Cleveland and you say, this is great, I can't wait to move to Spokane and use the system there. Now, I don't think Spokane has one, but Seattle has one. You go to Seattle, but they're going to have a completely different kind of data, different level of depth. So it's very much a grassroots no systemization across that, although it's a learning community that's always enhancing itself. And then we have a couple of initiatives that came online in the late 90s from the National Center for Charitable Statistics at the Urban Institute and United Way, trying to make usually asset data available to community members. So these were within specific initiatives trying to increase the availability of data for particular ends. And then the fourth one that I mentioned, this Open Indicators Consortium, which still has maybe 15 cities in it, came on in the late 2000s with a focus on visualization of data. And then the initiative I want to talk about is also from Urban Institute called the Community Platform, which came online in 2010. So this Community Platform, and trust me, I'm not getting any kind of kickback from Urban Institute. This is all out of the good of my heart. And the reason that my colleagues and I selected this was because it was the first time that we had an initiative that was centralized, that was made available across the country at relatively low cost, and it was standardized. The base Community Platform system was already set up with particular kinds of data, and then it could be tailored to local needs. So every one of the Community Platform sites, and I'll show you what they look like in a moment, have community need data from the US Census, and they also marry in community resource data from 990 data at the IRS. So that comes automatically from the Urban Institute to these partners. And then the local partners who sponsor the site can add additional data that they have, that they've negotiated with community partners to add it to the site. They can have profiles of their nonprofits and put additional detail about individual nonprofits. There's a sharing option and workspace for nonprofits to collaborate and partner on this site. So it was designed to be a, if not, you know, plug and play kind of option. It took out a lot of the pre-thinking that sites needed to do and gave them an immediate base of data that could be useful to partners. So there are 22 of these community platform sites across the country. They all have that base as I described, but some of them have some deeper data. It's that marrying of assets with indicators. And this is an example from the Louisiana Initiative for Nonprofit and Community Collaboration Link, which is in, I think it's in four parishes in northern Louisiana. And this is just an example of the kind of mapping that they could do. And these are poverty data shaded in the background, and these are charity locations from this. And you could hover over each of those and see the name, and depending on whether the profiles have been added, you can actually see their capacity and how many staff they have and that sort of thing. So my colleague Jeff Brudney and I had been, who was formerly at Cleveland State and is now at UNC, had become interested in the work of the Community Platform. And so we approached Urban Institute and said we wanted to do some work to explore how implementation was going in these sites. And they agreed to help us. We were given contact information, and we conducted phone interviews with the majority of the sites in late 2013. We were asking them things about, why did you do this? How hard has it been? Where are you in the process? What does the partnership look like? What has been the influence of this system? And keep in mind, in the back of my head, I know about NeoCanDo as one of the oldest systems. And I know about the difficulties of a mature system. So this was looking at brand new startup efforts and the challenges that they were facing. So this is a map of the sites that were involved. And what you can see is the shading here tells you the level of geography that they were focused on. So for example, in Albuquerque, that was a statewide community platform site. Jacksonville was just the metro area. Some were cities, some were multi-county, three statewide. And that is a key decision that we saw that many of these partners had to face. What is the right geography for a community data system? And it actually was a flashpoint among partners about deciding how to proceed, because some people said, well, the state is the thing that's the most sensible. But that did not resonate with ground level community partner organizations who were interested in their two county or a metro area and the like. So if you sum up what these look like, we do have some statewide. Those that were multi-county, if NeoCanDo would be in that multi-county group, some metro area, some very narrow, single county, and three of them actually cross state lines, which is, if you think about the data implications, that increases your headache factor dramatically when you have, now you want to include data from two state jurisdictions. So New Mexico, a statewide example, shared Lehigh Valley, a multi-county. DC is metro. Brevard County in Florida is this county, single county. And four counties around Fargo, North Dakota, which helped me out. What's the state that's next to North Dakota? Minnesota, is that right? Okay, so it's right on the border there. I should have known that. So we explored who led the efforts, who thought this up, who brought people together to push for having this site exist. Community foundations were the most dominant category of bring, because they had already defined their community. They had some money, and I should say that the fee to have a community platform site was totally negotiated between the community and Urban Institute, but from what we understand, communities that wanted it, they would bring the cost way down to just a few thousand dollars. Those that were more affluent might have paid $20,000 for the startup, and then relatively modest support year to year after that. But other foundation, other nonprofit organizations often pushed for getting data. So an aging nonprofit was influential in one of the Florida sites. They said, we've got, that's our community, we've got to have better data. There were also associations of nonprofits, which tend to be more statewide, who said, our entire sector needs better data. And then in a couple cases, universities were the host. And then, so that's who really pushed the work. In terms of who was involved, actually most of the sites, and I'll make this point in a moment, you know, you would think that they'd have a lot of people involved in the discussion, but the experience is that they actually don't, that they keep it very narrow. They often keep it to a funder and just a couple of other organizations. And then later, after they launch it, they try to engage the community, which is tends to be less successful than doing that engagement up front. Why did they pursue these, making community data available? So the greens here are agreement, things like needs assessment, program development, communicating to philanthropic funders were very high on that motivation factor. But they also had other objectives, for example, engaging individual donors and volunteers. They imagined a site where people could go and learn about nonprofits and make an individual donor decision, or make a decision about to give some volunteer time. They also, and this is also one of the challenges, the more of these they said yes to, the more likely it was that the thing would kind of struggle under its own weight. So they had this external focused to the donor volunteer community, but they also, some of them wanted to focus on individuals in need, so that individual clients could go online and look up nonprofits and say, oh, this is just down the street from me. Here, I can see on the map. And that's a whole nother clientele that could be using the site. To a greater extent, they saw this as an opportunity to network with their partner organizations, gain visibility, publicize their services. But you know, really, it kind of, I think the most consensus was around the top three, which were evaluating need, designing programs, and being in touch with our philanthropic funders. And certainly, if the philanthropic funders were pushing for these data, they were communicating that expectation right out of the gate. So just a couple of comments here around motivations, because in the interviews we had to ask them kind of some pro forma questions about who was involved and who called the meetings and that kind of thing. But then we went down a next level to describe what that was like. How was the collaboration? How did decisions get made? And I think everybody was bullish on these systems. They said how many times somebody said, we always wanted more data, and here this thing from Urban Institute fell in our lap. It was a turnkey solution, and all we had to do was find $10,000 and get it. And then they realized, okay, we got it. Now what? You know, now what do we do with it? And the larger expectation, how do you get a community to use it? How do you get those various target audiences, nonprofit executives, clients, volunteers, donors, how do you get them to come to a site like that and effectively use the data? So the challenges of both what the system should look like and how easy it should be to use was correlated with cost of modifying the system beyond what Urban Institute had initially prepared. Some of them were successful in nesting the work with a university where it became part of their mission and they took on some of the technical aspects. So this is, I think in general, I would say the swath of motivations, there was a sobering reality even once they went live with their sites that they may have been a little too, their eyes were bigger than their stomach, if you will. So a few themes that came up consistently across the sites that I just wanted to share with you. There's no question the energy around the mission to get more data into the hands of nonprofits was palpable across all these communities. There was a rallying cry. They were, if not marching in the street, in their hearts they were marching in the street. It was less about why. We just need more data. If we had more data, we could solve so many more problems. But they hadn't really thought through once we get it. It's like my dog, you know, he wants to get the skunk, and then when he finally got the skunk, he did not know what he wanted to do with it. He's like, this is not what I expected. aside from a bath and milk or whatever we had to do with him. A second thing is this notion that geography is destiny. So these systems have to have a specific geography. You have to make a decision about where to draw the line. Some data are in and some data are out. And when you do that, you necessarily, potentially, alienate some partners. Because somebody always wants to go bigger and somebody always wants to go smaller. And so you have to find a way to get a consensus view and not end up with a community data platform that has a geographic definition that people don't understand. Like, how is that my community? So some of them look a little bit like gerrymandered districts, where they were trying to keep some organization involved, but then when you see it in its fullness, you say, is that really our community? And then another theme that was consistent was this notion that we start small, we run this thing from a very small leadership body, and then we go out to the nonprofit community and get them to use it. And we beg them to use it, and we cajole them. And in some cases, funders arm-twisting organizations to use it. And that being less successful than having this be a community process that had more engagement about what the system would look like. And that gets to the last point about these have largely been top-down enterprises with a lot of funder-driven interest, but are now in a phase where they're trying to build the bottom-up decision-making to make them sustainable over time. All right, I feel that I have run ahead of myself on this one. A couple other points here on the challenge end, and I think we can understand how this might happen. The marketing of the value of these systems, and this has certainly been our experience with Neo Can Do, is how do you market a system that's free, that has data in it? How do you get people to understand what it might be able to do for them? And we've, a lot of these sites, as have we in Cleveland, tried to use different methods, like doing case stories or little vignettes about people that have made a difference in their work using data, doing orientations and trainings. But all those strategies to enhance use cost money. And none of these systems had money to do that. They got the money to get the system and hadn't thought about what it takes to support the system as a community tool. And so that's one of the major learnings, is how do you support the sustainability of this work over time? And in some cases, overcoming perceptions of redundancy, that why do we need that system? United Way has 2-1-1. Why do we need this other thing? And so sometimes it was turf wars, and sometimes it was just misunderstanding about what the impetus was. So how many times have nonprofits underestimated the resources needed to do anything? My experience is that's kind of our, we always want to make things cheaper than they actually are because we're nonprofit. And I think in this case, it followed suit with every other program that these partners have delivered. On the incentive side for nonprofits, aside from the desire to do a better job and understand need and build a better program, one of the key advantages that many nonprofits saw in this is that here was a place where their IRS 990 data comes in and they could correct it. Now, not the financials, but they could correct their operating location, which on the IRS 990 was a PO box or a lawyer's office. And here on the local page, they could show their 4 service locations and describe the capacity of each. So that was a huge incentive for many nonprofits to do that, just that. They also found it very productive to use some of the project management and sharing tools on the site, which really wasn't part of the data, but it was just additional functionality. It got them used to the site, and what we found is that partners that were on the site using other functionality were more likely to then, maybe I'll take a look at the data. And then it would kind of soften the fear factor. And then lastly, at least 3 sites, funders that were involved as a prerequisite for somebody applying for funding to the foundation, they said you must have an updated profile of your organization on the community platform site. So extortion. And by gosh, it worked. They made profiles and they kept their data up to date. And from the flip side, the funder said, we are now going to do our due diligence on grantees by looking at the community platform site and the National Center for Charitable Statistics and a couple others. So they said, we're going to use this, so please make your data current. So to kind of bring to a close here, I think that the experience through this initiative, though it had a lot of upfront energy, is that if we go back to that community building focus for our nonprofits, it ended up being more driven by a small group, and then it was retrospective in nature. So they brought in the solution and then tried to retrofit it to community partners through various tactics. And you know, the majority of these sites recommended to other communities that are starting to include a diverse group of stakeholders, even though we didn't. So that was a powerful conclusion in that, and it's a recognition, but I also want, it's, you know, it will run counter to the expeditiousness that many of the partners had. They wanted to go live with these sites quickly, and if you convene a community process, this is going to consume time, and you have to be invested in what that's going to yield, and that so that there's an education process for the partners. So some things that came also, if we were restarting, I think for any community that's trying to push for more data availability, having those key champions and partners to both invest in the site but also promote its use, the funding, the cross-site or cross-organization sharing, and critically, thinking not about when will we go live, but the idea that once we have this, how will we support its use by community members? Because it will not happen without an activist stance to get people to use it. Oh, I'm gonna just mention the practitioner angle here. There were some findings for the folks who make community platform, the technology, a lot of complaints about different minutiae about how their sites operate and frustrations with that, as you would expect. A call for educational institutions to do more training and professional development for nonprofits to make use of systems like this, more data savvy nonprofit practitioners. And then to think about how, you know, street level practitioners can, if this is not part of their job, how this could be something that could be an asset to them in their thinking about their own work. So coming back to Cleveland, I just wanted to encourage you, you know, I think we have visitors from around the country come to Cleveland because we are known for having more data than most communities. Our NeoCanDo system, which is based upstairs in the Poverty Center, has this long history, and we have data on social and economic indicators and housing. If you want to visit it, we have people who say, well, we want to visit NeoCanDo. Like, well, it's not much to look at. You can look at the server. And we're always tickled when the plain dealer says, attributes things to NeoCanDo. NeoCanDo says, really? NeoCanDo said something? It's just a web-based system. So one of our biggest training things that we've done over time is how to not misuse NeoCanDo. NeoCanDo puts out data, and you can tell the wrong story or make a mistake as you can with any data. A couple of national data sources from the census that are specific to Cleveland, the Fact Finder and Quick Facts, both offer kind of initial profiles and tables, and then you can go down to lower levels and look at age groups and some of that. And I'll just say that, you know, if you ever have a question about, I wonder if they have data on X, that's something you can contact us at the Poverty Center and ask us that question, and we'll try to put you on the right track. And then the Federal Reserve Bank of Cleveland also has regional data, more economic focused and employment, but also accessible in a fairly user-friendly way. So what's my charge, I think, going forward? If we have the desire to have better data, we need a wish list. We need our shopping list of what's on that, what those key data needs are. And to spend time thinking about the specific data needs and potential sources for those and what the barriers are to use. Because sometimes the barrier is the data don't exist, and sometimes it is we can't get it. And those are require two different responses when those are true. We have to do a better job of building capacity in organizations, so staffing capacity for folks that can work with data to meet organizational needs, and or invest in intermediaries who can do that on behalf of the organizations and work directly with them. There's also the advent of integrated data, which increasingly offers opportunities for cross-organizational work. Here at the Poverty Center, we have the CHILD system, which is the Childhood Integrated Longitudinal Data System. It is an integrated data system on all children born in Cuyahoga County starting in 1992. And we link together records from birth certificates and lead exposure and child maltreatment and public assistance and school data at the individual child level. And increasingly, we're able to use those data to, so just as an example, we have been working with suburban school districts to get access to school district data from the inner ring suburbs. And one of the first things we are able to do for them is for a recent entry cohort of kindergartners, match their students against the data that we have, and we can give them a profile on their children who have entered kindergarten about what happened to those children prior to kindergarten. How many of them were living in a family using food stamps for X period? How many of them had a lead exposure? How many of them had been the focus of a abuse and neglect report and the like? So it's the idea that, you know, we have community data because we have community problems that need response. And I should, as a nonprofit or government entity, if I am limited in what I know by the data that I hold, that is going to result in a very inefficient and ineffective response to community issues that cross those lines. So I feel strongly that if we can make better use of these data, we can kind of grow the evidence base for the sector. I've got a couple publications, and I think I will stop right there. How we do?
Do we have any questions? And I wanted to remind people who are connecting remotely that Abby Asmus is a second year master's student, and she is staffing the computer back there.
When you talk about collecting information across agencies on individual people, do you run into HIPAA and those kinds of things that would prevent you from tracking a client from one agency to another?
Absolutely. Yes.
And how do you overcome that?
That is a HIPAA and FERPA would be the first two, and then just generically individual privacy protections. How do we do that? We've been successful in that the work that we do is governed by an institutional review board, and the data are protected in a secure server. So we negotiate individual data use agreements with those partners to share identifiable data. There are clauses within HIPAA that allow the sharing of data, and in FERPA. I will say that most of the data that we have have no health information in them. So HIPAA rarely comes up. The more frequent one is educational data from the school districts. And only in a couple of instances do we actually have individual informed consent before data can enter the system. It's mostly institutional level data. So all the analyses are, it's not about the individuals. The individual data is only used to link records together, and then it's stripped off. The analyses are all of de-identified data.
Thank you.
Thanks for the question. Who's got the stock question? Somebody? come. Yes.
Just thinking about the educational data aspect in your CHILD system, what kind of educational data do you track across the schools in the area, and how does our kind of grading system that keeps changing in Ohio affect that?
Yeah, and that's a broader issue for any data source where you might secure access. These data systems are created with a particular use and aim in mind, and you really need to understand the decisions that went behind how variables were created and how they're coded. On your particular question, The school district data that we receive, we largely focus on attendance. So this is each grade level, attendance, daily attendance, so that we can look at absenteeism. Grades are really not, they're there. Those are not something that we analyze because of the unknowns about difference in grading across instructors. But we look at repeated grades, proficiency test scores, and normal credit completion to advance to the next grade.
Earlier you mentioned the idea that if you're looking for data and either it's not available or you're not allowed to access it,
yeah.
When you're creating these databases and you have this wish list of what you want to cover, how do you handle those walls, those speed bumps when you're trying to fill in the gaps?
Where it exists and you can't get it?
Yeah.
Well, you cannot enter a room in most communities and that has anything to do with government or nonprofit service and not hear somebody utter the phrase collective impact. And if we really believe collective impact is a construct of merit, then the natural course is collective data to support collective impact. And that means that we have to find a way to share these data to inform practice and policy. So I think we have to amp up our requests. And that means in a meeting when partners come together to discuss data sharing, you can see when they initially come in, there it's closed. It's, you're not getting anything from me. It's like, show me yours and then I'll show you mine kind of thing, is the mentality. I think the funders and county government have to be willing to support the work because nonprofits don't have the technology and capacity to actually carry out the linkage. What we find around the community is they have to find some entity who is trusted that they are willing to share their data with. So in Milwaukee, it's the school district. Nonprofits give their data to the school district and they're collecting it. Here, it just happens to be that at a university-based research center, we've become the repository that people are willing to share with. But in other places, it's municipal in Philadelphia, it's the city of Philadelphia that has integrated data. So it is a evolutionary process in every community. Karen.
Thanks. Rob, I was wondering, so Cleveland and NeoCanDo is not a member. It's not a community platform location.
No, we're not.
Correct?
That's okay. Right.
But given where you're housed and the interest that we have in nonprofits here, are there efforts to integrate some of the nonprofit location data and resource data into NeoCanDo? And are there activities that are going on now to do that, like different sectors like aging or child services or other things?
Yes, and that is a great question. And that is, we have talked for a number of years about adding Form 990 data to NeoCanDo so that in mapping functions you could have that. It's simply a matter of resources. And thus far we have not had any partners that were willing to underwrite that. That would be a major initiative. While it comes prepackaged in the community platform, for us, because we have this extant system that we have to find a way to build it in. But that's definitely on my agenda to support the region.
You had talked about some of the, I think, more K-12 focused education data that you have been tracking. Can you talk at all about what in the higher ed space the child system kind of keeps an eye on, if anything?
No, well, I can, but it won't take long. We have not really gotten into the school's data that we have goes up to high school graduation. We don't have anything on education beyond that. The only instance where we've done something there was with the Promise neighborhood in Central, where we tried to follow children coming from those schools into college going, by use of FAFSA data to see if they had applied and whether they'd enrolled. But those were really small numbers to track. We haven't done it with the full population. So we, as a system, we really started with a focus on early childhood, and we've been building up the age spectrum, and we just haven't gotten there. Dr. Nixon?
Rob, just yesterday in my 478 class, we had a panel of five or six executive directors of community centers address the class, telling us about what they needed in terms of community needs assessment and how we could possibly, with teams of students, go in and support and partner with them into conducting needs assessment. And one of the frustrations that came across from these community leaders with the era of accountability and outcomes that we live in that you mentioned is that oftentimes there isn't enough opportunity for the community organizations to go out into the community to really find out what the residents want. But they have these superimposed outcomes and results from funders, so they feel a bit of being in sort of a lockdown. Mm. What can be done about that? That was a big concern and frustration.
Well, two things on that. One is that, you know, where do the resources come from to do the needs assessment? And I certainly know of many who organizations and even funders who they can come up with a few thousand dollars to do a needs assessment, which is going to force you to focus on readily available social indicator data that you can pull off your computer, not face-to-face work with residents, which is going to take infinitely more time. So that it requires a bigger investment to actually, you know, work with the authentic need and the community members. Which is forthcoming, I hope. I don't know that we really have a solution there. I think what I'm concerned about is that there's a whole cottage industry of vendors who have sprouted up to do these needs assessments, and they can do it from remotely. They can do, and this is true in healthcare, where all the hospitals have to have their needs assessments done. And I just worry that what you just described is even more accentuated as the emphasis on we have to have a needs assessment, we have to check the box, but it's not so important that it's truly reflective of community experience. Thank you. There's a hand in the back.
Is there a lot of research or resources on distinguishing between metrizable data versus like data that can't be put into metrics, like say for example, like test scores versus influences on like a student that would allow that test score and stuff like that?
So specific to educational data?
Oh no, just using that as an example. Like are there resources out there or research, is there research done on distinguishing what can and what cannot be put into a metric?
Well, that's an interesting question. I suppose the general response is the data that we're usually hunting up was, you know, we're fortunate. We don't have to recollect the data. It's already been collected by somebody else, but that means we have to live with every decision they made to create the data that we're now getting essentially for free. And that means that we probably don't like a lot of the decisions they made. They didn't measure it right. So a lot of times we're looking for proxies in the data that reflect the construct that we think is correct, and we don't have a direct measurement of it. So there's always a point where you need to kind of do a sensitivity analysis and decide whether this proxy that we have complete data on is really reflecting the true, you know, meaningful construct that we're after. And if it doesn't match up, we still have the option to go out and collect new data, which we always had from the beginning. That never disappears.
I think this goes a little bit to Dr. Nixon's question also, but that 6% utilization of the data, is that because we're asking for data that funders want and not what we need, or is it because we don't know how to use data, or is it because we don't have people on staff to deal with data, or is it because we don't have an application for the data? Well, can, is there any
well,
applicability?
I think you have answered the question. It's all those influences. But what I know for sure is that nonprofits got tired of the question, do you have any data? And now they can answer yes. But then when the second question comes, do you analyze it? Then it's, well, we look at it. I mean, I don't know how many partners we've had where they say, oh yeah, we got tons of data. Here's a stack of it. Okay. That's not really readily available for decision making, is it? But it is all those, I think capacity would do a lot, to those investments in capacity and technology to make it, you know, I think dashboards can help nonprofits, but they're really just the simplest starting place for the dialogue. It is something, and it's going to favor those things that are easily measured, maybe not the right things, as was pointed out. So, thank you. Are we ready to, oh, Cleve. Oh, the dean. Oh, good. I thought you were going to ask a question.
Oh, no. I did have a question, but somebody else has asked it in a better way. So I'm Cleve Gilmore. I'm the dean of the Mandel School, and it's Professor Tracy is giving me the opportunity at these events to close out, to be the closer. And, and of course, you know, we've really enjoyed this presentation on such an important topic, but I have to tell you, I have a different perspective. One of the pleasures of my job is that I get to read the teaching evaluations of every faculty member every year. But I don't often get to participate in a class with them. So this was an opportunity for me to participate in a presentation by one of our stellar teachers, Rob Fisher, and you've got to see why he is such a favorite among the students. And so Rob, I want to thank you for a great presentation. Thank you for highlighting the important work that you and Claudia and other members of the Poverty Center are doing and have been doing for over 25 years, especially in the creating of Neo Can Do, and talking about what the opportunities are for partnership, not only with our people here, but also partnership in the nonprofit community for making a better impact in Cleveland and our larger community. So
thank you.
Thank you all, and please join me in applauding his efforts.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming today.